Okay, so I'm here today. We're speaking with John Rollins, a man who really needs no introduction, but I'm going to give him one anyway. John is probably one of the most famous rock and roll photographers out there, photographer ever.
Not photographer ever, but certainly in rock and roll music.
Yeah.
I've had my fair share, very happy for that, and all interest driven. Mm-hmm. You know, not a corporate job or anything, but
you've taken photographs of pretty much everybody, every iconic figure that you can think of in the world of rock and roll, and you've taken photographs of everybody. How did you get your start, and how did it develop into?
Well, it came from an interest in media and music at the same time as a 10, 11, 12 year old kid, and fascination by it and asking questions, and ultimately the questions came down as, well, how do I meet these people, how do I get in touch with people that know these people? And in Ottawa, 1960, September 26, I paid a buck and a half to go and see Brenda Lee, who was a teenage heartthrob in the 60s who had 10 number one hits on the charts. Radio was very important in media in those days. And I went down, and normally in those days, as an amateur photographer with family concerns, a roll of film might take 6 months to shoot. Two pictures at the barbecue, two shots when granddad came over, and Queen Mother came to town and waved at the crowd, you'd grab another shot or two there, and 6 months would go by and you process it at the drugstore. So off to, I go to Brenda Lee, I shoot 12 whole shots, one roll of film. And enjoyed the concert. I used to see her on the Perry Como show every week. And after the show, nobody ushering you out when the show's over in those days. Kids just went home. Mm-hmm. So walking out, I looked down a corridor, and there's a sign saying Brenda Lee in the casuals dressing room. So maybe I'll just tell Brenda I like the show. And knocked on the door, and her mother answered, and I looked up and said, I just came to tell Brenda I enjoyed the show, and she said, well, why don't you come in? She's sitting right over there. Tell her yourself.
Mm.
So I thanked her for the show and asked her some questions about homeschooling on the road while she toured. I was 13, she was 15.
So you were only 13 when this all started. Wow. And this is something that you pursued on your own, that you wanted
to? Well, it was a personal interest. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought maybe I could meet the girl, and if we liked each other, maybe we'd have a date or two, you know. But, you know, 900 miles away in Nashville, that wasn't going to happen. But I became very happy that at that point, the only way she'd come home with me is in the camera. So.
Now, you're here from here in London, Ontario. This is where you...
Yeah, I was born in Oshawa, but my dad was in the Air Force, so every 4 years we moved. Mm-hmm. And we were here 54 to 58, and then we moved from here to Ottawa, and that's where I got my feet on the ground up there. And, but the early interest came from watching early television here. Dad let us watch Elvis Presley on the Ed Sullivan Show, so it was pretty outrageous. But Dad was a broadcaster. He was in the business after the war, and he was on the morning show shifts in Oshawa and Moncton, New Brunswick, and then back to Oshawa again. And he also had an avid interest in serious amateur photography, so I combined two of his amusements in my so-called gig and so-called future, and it worked out well.
So. Well, it definitely has worked out quite well for you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, from your start in Ottawa, how did it progress? How did you start getting in touch with, like, Beatles and Stones and Bowie and...
It fed itself. Brenda's people said, they phoned me back in 1960 and had my phone number, because they said, stay in touch, we'd like to see your shots. And they sent me a check for $35, which is big money in those days. And then said, we've got another friend of ours who manages recording acts, and his entertainer's coming to Ottawa. Go and shoot the interview on the radio station, and the manager will give you $50 cash. 13-year-old kid, that's a nice electric mm-hmm. guitar. So I went, and it was Sam Cooke.
Mm.
And that catapulted me into meeting Bobby V in Ottawa, Duane Eddy in Ottawa, the Ventures in Ottawa as they played through on Dick Clark Caravan of Stars type thing. And then family move brought us to Scarborough and took off from there with wanting to get hooked up with a record company. So had experience with an Ottawa band called the Esquires that just got signed by Capitol, went down and met Paul White, who did the 6,000 series on British bands, and Fred from Strathroy has a display of those singles here. And Paul said, gee, maybe you could do some pictures of Jerry and the Pacemakers for us, and then after that, Dave Clark Five's coming, and then after that, so on and so on. But got me on the road with Jerry and the Pacemakers in Canada, and then the Dave Clark Five in Canada. Mm-hmm. And that got me into the British invasion, and 65, I did the Beatles at Maple Leaf Gardens, and the Beatles in 66 again, and worked with George Harrison in 74 on his tour, Paul McCartney 75 on Wings Over America, and of course 69, John and Yoko in the Peace campaign. So, mm-hmm. was out at Ronnie Hawkins' place, met them out there. We zoomed around in snowmobiles, hung out with the grand piano, and all that kind of stuff. And it just rolled me into from there the Animals, Herman's Hermits, and so on, as far as Brit went. And everything else just seemed to come around. And then I started doing magazine work in the U.S., and it just cascaded and kept going.
Now you've, I mean, the Beatles are one thing. You had a close relationship as well with David Bowie, and I know myself included, a lot of people were upset this year with David's passing. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about your work with David Bowie as well.
Well, I was shooting RCA Records stuff, and one of the nice facilities about being official with the record companies, it wasn't going to be any inquiry as to why do you want pictures, John. I said, well, I work for RCA, so it's your benefit. I'm already cleared with the record company, and I'd casually ask, you know, can I get some stage passes to shoot the show? They were always interested, so that's how I got in the David Bowie door and got to meet him at a couple of gold and platinum record presentations, and then it just rolled from there. Once we get contact and then they see examples of my work, then it's pretty sure that they're going to hire me. So, mm-hmm. And that's how I started with David in 76. I did some dates on the Station to Station tour. And because I really enjoyed his music and the whole creative vehicle that he created all around, I wanted to impress him. So I put a dark room in my hotel room every night. After the show, I'd come back, process the film, hang the negs to dry, and then go out and sleep. And next morning, David and I would have breakfast and look at contact sheets.
Wow.
And after one day of doing that, he was very quick in going through them all, and I thought, gosh, he doesn't like anything. So I was about to slide under the door and go back to my room, and he said, tell you what, they want 6 new shots. You pick them and tell them I picked those. And after that, we'll still have our meetings so you can still understand my direction, but then we'll talk about a lot of other things. So I had 19 breakfasts with David on that tour.
So he was really into the creative process along
photography. And I tell people now that the most often used words in conversations with David casually was the word creative. Mm-hmm. And then I visited him on the Sound and Vision tour in 92 and 93. And after a catch up, and I showed him the first Archer print at that point, he said, come on out, I want to introduce you to all the creative people he hired for that tour. Mm-hmm. And it was handshake, name by name. He knew all the projectionists, all the people doing special effects for him, and all the sound crew and stuff. And he just said, I wanted you to meet somebody that I have great respect for. And that was me.
So excellent.
I was very impressed. Very
excellent.
Impressed.
So he really incorporated you into the process of creating the imagery. And mm-hmm. it was, I guess, a team effort in building his work.
Yeah. And you know, when you can deal with somebody that thinks and feels the same way emotionally about what you're shooting as he is when he created it. Mm-hmm. You know, I shot the Archer, and I asked him, I said, why did you pull that pose? He said, well, basically it was a spotlight cue. Mm-hmm. When you released the arrow, it was a cue to the spotlight guy that dropped black.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, do you remember what song it was in? He goes, no.
And that's probably one of the most iconic photos of Bowie.
It was one of his favorite photos ever of his career. He told me that, and I have an autograph at home for it.
So. Excellent.
Yeah, brilliant man. And, you know, it was a long time since we actually spoke and saw each other, but I had a certain comfort that I could always think about David Bowie and think of the future. Mm-hmm. Whatever he was doing was going to be okay. But on you know, 2 days after his birthday, when he passed away, it was a severe shock.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I think everybody was overwhelmed by,
yeah,
by that.
Yeah.
Well, now, I mean, with photography these days, you see, I've got this camera here. Everybody's got their flip phones, their camera,
yeah,
phones and stuff. But you grew up during the nitty-gritty of it. As you said, you had your own darkroom. You're developing your own stuff. What do you think about photography the way it was then compared to the way people are trying to do it today with electronic devices?
Well, I mean, it's all okay. You can't fault people for that. And, you know, some people say to me, well, there's no more professionalism in photography. And, well, it's still there.
Mm-hmm.
And professional photography has to live up to its definition as well. But cell phones are just kids recording who they are and what they're doing. And certainly it's a strong social structure, there's no doubt. But at the same time, you're not going to be shooting ads for magazines. You're not going to be shooting video on your cell phone that's going to be broadcast quality for serious TV shows. And I'm sure there'll be it'll get a little closer to that maybe, but I don't think it'll take over. And the serious guys that train for it, like the video crews in here today, three of them, all sharp young kids who know their stuff, you know. And it's not just the next generation of cell phones that elevates them to better pictures, better videos, because the creative mind will figure it out. And you could do it with a 1-pixel camera. That was the first digital camera I got. I got an Epson camera, 1 pixel or 1 megapixel.
Wow.
When I bought a $200 printer. And I did do one. I was caught in a speaking position and could sit down with Tim Curry. And I did Tim Curry's portrait on a 1-megapixel camera.
Wow.
And they looked okay, you know, so. But it's the guy with the camera that takes the picture, not the camera, you know. And that's what I've always felt. When I went to Ryerson in 1970, there was a guy who got into the course. His whole portfolio was shot on what they used to call Instamatic cameras.
Mm-hmm.
That had a flash cube. And people were saying, well, gee, he shot the whole portfolio on his Instamatic. I said, no, but it was his brain that figured out the whole picture. He just had an Instamatic. I had a Hasselblad and Rolleiflex 2¼ square, much better optics, but his ideas, through whatever vehicle he had, being an Instamatic, it worked for him. Got him in the course.
So it's really the artist that's responsible,
yeah, exactly,
for the art.
Yeah.
Not the device that they,
yeah,
used to produce.
And see, David mastered it all. He was, mm-hmm, sound, lighting, he wrote the music, he had dreams when he was a kid and got concepts for songs, designed the costumes, sketched in the set, mm-hmm, built the set to specs, and toured.
Mm-hmm.
So he was totally his own entity. His own world was David Bowie creating David Bowie. Any direction, or, you know, he was always a man of mystery.
Mm-hmm.
You count on him for something obvious, he wouldn't show. You know? You count on him walking across the street to have a sandwich with you. Say, hey, Dave, what are you doing here, man? You know, got a baseball cap on and a windbreaker and tennis shoes. You know? So he really lived the life, you know, and had a home in Bermuda, Upper State New York, London, Munich, and Berlin. So, but totally creative man. Wonderful, wonderful person.
Well, you're definitely a wonderful person as well. I mean, you've worked with Bowie, the Beatles, just examples, Bob Marley. I mean, the list goes on. I could go on for a half an hour about all the people that you photographed. If people are interested in working with you, how do they get in touch with you?
Well, I'm on Facebook. You can track me down there. I've got a website called spotlightheroes.com. You can find me there. Or Google search me Rockin' Rollins or John Robert Rollins, photographer. And somewhere along the line, phone numbers, addresses, and whatnot will come up. That's usually the easiest way I say, you know.
And you have tons of published works out there that are available as well.
Yeah, two books. I'm going to do another line of posters soon, and third book on its way.
Excellent.
And I'm doing more speaking engagements now. I've done 12 cities in 2 years, and very happy with the audience reaction, seeing the memories on slides and whatnot that I speak about, telling the backstories. So I think that's the way to do it. A lot of the superstructure of music being radio stations and whatnot on the demise, and the music's changing. So go out and talk about what you know best, show them pictures from those days, and they refresh and they're happy for the memories. So.
Excellent. You're going to be here this weekend at the London Beatles Festival in London. And so if you want to come down and see John, he's going to be set up just outside here. So come on down to the London Beatles Festival in London, Ontario this weekend and see John Rollins and all his iconic photography over the years and the work that he's done with numerous, numerous individuals, including the Beatles.
All right.
Well, thanks for being with us today, John.
Thank you so much.